Last time, when the religious practices of people who say they believe what I believe has been such a matter of life and death, was the war in Vietnam. I should know better than to be surprised. As the songwriter David Byrne would say, same as it ever was. Religion has been used to punish the outsider since forever. But what is emerging in our own time is a new ferocity aimed at those who are unable to defend themselves. The predator will always single out the weak. If we approach our religious life seriously as a deeply spiritual and religious thing, a deeply felt effort to imbue our existence with ethics and a devotion to the experience of a higher power, then it matters what we believe and what we do. We take our ethical standards out into the world, into the lives we live. We don't let it slide off of us when we hear of someone we know who is suffering and could use a phone call or a visit. Or if we read something that makes us shudder, we act on our beliefs. We don't turn a blind eye. But now there is a sizable faction of self-described Christians who are beating us over the head, insisting that their viewpoint become law. The right to terminate a pregnancy was put to the test this week when a 10-year-old girl, a fourth grader, had to cross state lines to end a pregnancy that was started by her being sexually assaulted. And the state of Ohio had made it illegal to do it there because they believe that someone who isn't old enough to babysit should be forced to have a baby. Someone who has been forced into a sexual assault must then be forced into a pregnancy that her body and her own personal self are not ready for. This is an issue of religious freedom, and it is our faith, the Presbyterian tradition, that is being denied in the full range of its practice. We never said they had to have abortions, but they say we have no right to have one. And it is also stunningly anti-Semitic to deny the Jewish people their rights to practice their beliefs. So let's start with them. I think we can all agree we do not want the United States to start persecuting Jewish people for their religious beliefs, right? There are several definitions going on regarding the term when life begins. In the Jewish tradition, they generally settle on the idea that life begins when we first draw a breath. Human life in the Bible began when God breathed life into the mud man, the Adama, Adam. Before the fetus draws a breath, it is part of the mother. And if the mother's life is in danger, or if the mother's well-being is in danger, then the family is required to terminate the pregnancy, because the life of the mother is paramount. A 2014 Pew Research survey found that of more than 800 Jewish people surveyed, 83% said that abortion should be legal in most or all cases. The medical definition of when life begins is a technical description that when the fertilized egg is implanted in the wall of the uterus, then it begins to be alive. If it does not implant, it will never continue. And if you think about it, the egg is alive, the sperm is alive, but we do not grant them the same legal status as some would a zygote. But fervent anti-abortion, anti-choice zealots say that life begins at conception. That is not a factual statement. It is a religious belief. And it is a belief cloaked in the marketing term pro-life. I disagree with the title, because if they were really pro-life, they would advocate for free healthcare for all women who are pregnant. According to the Commonwealth Fund, the US has a rate of 17.4 deaths in childbirth per 100,000 women. France has a rate of 8.7, which is half of our rate. And New Zealand has a rate of 1.7. Why is our death rate almost 9 times what it is in New Zealand? Because they have a national healthcare system. Our money goes into insurance companies. United Healthcare, the nation's largest insurer, had a $4 billion profit last year. They are listed as a nonprofit. I have a friend who worked a private party at the house of the CEO a few years back. He said they have a Van Gogh hung above the toilet in the small bathroom by the kitchen. That's where your premiums are going. Private insurance is not going to take care of poor women who are pregnant. Corporate America would rather let them die than cut profits. If they actually were pro-life, they would also advocate for the end of selling military hardware to civilians so that children would not get killed going to school. According to Fox News, studies in 2016 found that a roughly 30% spike in gun deaths between 2019 and 2020 made firearms the leading cause of death for children in the United States. Still true today. The CDC reported 4,368 child deaths by gunfire in 2020, the vast majority of which were homicides. Apparently, they are only pro-life before birth. Once you're born, well, too bad for you. These are commonly known facts. So how do we deal with them? How do we deal with people who have taken on an irrational belief system that they intend to install into the laws of our country and taking away our religious freedoms instead of protecting them? I become very angry when confronted with these arguments, and I have to be careful to remember my training. My mom always said, hate the sin and love the sinner. Well, I'm not there yet. It's everything I can do to not hate the sinner. And I know that's a problem because you inevitably become the thing you hate. If I start hating people because they have a severe case of indifference, of cold-heartedness, of mercilessness, then I risk becoming warped by it and becoming hard-hearted about them. It will be like what the Buddha says, that this is like drinking rat poison and expecting the rat to die. Let's look at the readings for today and maybe find some help. In Genesis, we see a positive example of living up to our spiritual beliefs. Hospitality is a spiritual practice, and Abraham goes all the way. He ran to them. He bowed. He offered water to wash their feet and shade to rest in. He had 3 cakes made. There was cake. And had a tender calf prepared. That's extravagance. And he has not yet asked them who they are, but he approaches them with a generosity of spirit. The story connects to Hebrews 13:2. Do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, some people have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it. These strangers bring good news. Now, Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age. They had given up the idea of having their own kids. The stranger said she would have a son. Sarah laughed to herself, skeptical as anyone should be when you're in your 90s. The stranger said, why did you laugh? Is anything beyond God? Verse 15, but Sarah denied it, saying, I did not laugh. For she was afraid to admit to the laugh and to admit to her doubt. He said, oh, yes, you did laugh. And when the son was born, they named him Isaac, which means laughter. The story is significant to us because it informs the viewpoint about abortions. In the ancient Near East, a woman was valued according to the productivity of her womb. Her primary role was to produce offspring for her husband, and especially to provide a son to inherit the family estate. Plus, sons can help defend the parents, while a daughter requires further protection. Being barren was a serious problem. It meant that the woman could not fulfill her purpose in life. Sarah doesn't have much of a choice here. The conversation between Abraham and the visitors directly concerns Sarah and her well-being. The guests announce that Sarah will have a child in due season, even though she is over 90 years old and well past childbearing age. Many have imagined that Sarah would have been joyful about becoming a mother. Would she have felt that way? That would be a guess. That would be conjecture. Going through labor in the ancient world was dangerous enough for a young female. Imagine how much more difficult pregnancy would be for Sarah. Her laughter in verse 10 was more about the ridiculousness of Abraham and her being able to do what was necessary to become pregnant. It is also important to remember that this is the first time Sarah has heard she is required to bear the child of promise. Abraham has heard it three times by now. This story underlines the patriarchal system of men making the decisions that women have to live with. The good news is that it worked out. Isaac was their son, Jacob was their grandson. That's why the story is so miraculous, so legendary, so mythical. But it's not precedent for us. Here's how one evangelical woman describes her beliefs that she was trained in on as a kid in the New Yorker. "I have always thought of abortion as it has been taught to me in school. It was a sin that irresponsible women committed to cover up another sin, having sex in a non-Christian manner." The moral universe was a stark battle of virtue and depravity, in which the only meaningful question about any possible action was whether or not it could be sanctioned in the eyes of God. Men were sinful, and the goodness of women was the essential bulwark against the corruption of the world. There was suffering built into this framework, but suffering was noble. Justice would prevail at the end because God always provided for the faithful. End quote. There's a lot here. Several assumptions are built into this particular evangelical viewpoint. One, men are evil. They can't help themselves. That's why they keep sexually abusing people in the church. And in the Roman church, they are transferred instead of being fired. Two, a woman's great value is in childbearing. Otherwise, her life is pointless. So an abortion negates her value and her worth as a person. Three, women are virtuous as long as they don't have sex outside of a consecrated marriage. If a woman decides to have a sexual relationship outside of marriage, she is evil as a man, and she deserves what's coming to her. Four, an unplanned pregnancy is a shameful thing, and she will be treated harshly because she carries the evidence of her sin. The man will not, because he is unmarked by the experience. And if she decides to terminate the pregnancy for any reason, she has compounded her sin. The idea that a fetus is not just a full human, but a superior and king-like one, a being whose survival is so paramount that another person can be legally compelled to accept harm, ruin, or death to ensure it, is a recent invention. For most of history, women ended unwanted pregnancies as they needed to, taking herbal or plant-derived preparations on their own or with the help of female healers and midwives who presided over all forms of treatment and care connected with pregnancy. So this is not an ancient ruling of the church, nor an ancient belief of the faith. There is nothing in the Hebrew Bible or the New Covenant, nothing in the Old Testament or the New Testament that says that abortion is prohibited. Nothing. So what we have here is an argument that has been constructed along lines that are not rational, not traditional, and not scientific. The anti-choice argument is based on a few assumptions. One, women are not capable of making their own decisions. Two, women only need abortions if they have had sex, which is evil. And if they have had sex outside of a marriage, they obviously do not have the wisdom to make a decision like ending a pregnancy. They are, however, wise enough to give birth and raise a child. Three, those decisions should be made by the government, preferably by a government dominated by white males who take direction from churches that do not ordain women. Because, you know, although women are not as evil as men, they are not wise enough or spiritual enough or smart enough to be ministers or pastors or priests. Four, married women, people who are sexually assaulted, children, women who could die from an ectopic pregnancy or other complications, none of them matter. Too bad for them. In the words of one priest, some women will die. Five, everyone who disagrees with this anti-choice viewpoint is also evil, and they should not have a voice in making their own decisions either. They should not be allowed to vote. As Robert McNamara said about Vietnam, rationality will not save us. So, where do we go from here? It took 50 years to get here, and it won't be resolved overnight. There will be chaos and hard feelings, anger and suffering until the political wave restores power to the majority instead of the minority rule that dominates our political system now. We have to actively support candidates of either party who support our ethical position on this matter of religious freedom, the same way we would about advocating for affordable housing. And we have to engage people who have not yet made up their minds. And we have to engage them with respect and by listening, and not by yelling at them or throwing punches around. Finally, what does the story of Mary and Martha tell us? Martha is doing what is expected of her, preparing the hospitality for guests, the way Sarah did when the men were making decisions for her. But Mary is defying expectations. She is listening to the teacher. She is learning from the rabbi. Jesus is also defying expectations. He is treating her like he would treat any other disciple. He is defending her hunger to learn. He treats her like she is a fully cognizant human being. Let's give Rachel Held Evans the final word on this. It wasn't shared social status or ethnicity that brought Jesus' followers together. No, if there is one thing that connected all these dissimilar people together, it was a shared sense of need, a hunger, a thirst, a longing. It was the certainty that when Jesus said he came for the sick, that meant Jesus came for me. And that is the viewpoint we need to speak from. That when we talk to those we disagree with, we say us and not them. Let us pray. Dear God, we have deep disagreements with our siblings in Christ. They aren't new disagreements, and they aren't going away anytime soon. But help us to keep our cool and to live out our own faith in advocating for justice and demanding rights for those who are at a disadvantage and in showing hospitality to people who we think don't deserve it. because there are times when we don't deserve it either. All this we ask in your name. Amen.